All right, we're going through the book of 1 John, so I encourage you to take your Bibles or access your device to 1 John 2:15, and today we're going to answer the question, what in the world is worldliness? Now, when it comes to relating to the world, some people say, well, as Christians, we should just retreat from the world. That's why we have monasteries, and that's why some people consider church to be a sanctuary, like a bird sanctuary, to sort of protect them from the evils of the world. In fact, I heard a funny story about a monk that joined a monastery and he took a vow of silence. They could only speak two words once a year. So after 1 year, the monk went to see his supervisor and he only had two words to say. He said, "Bed hard." And then he spent another year in silence and he came back and a year later he said to his supervisor, "Soup cold." And then he spent another year, and after 3 years, he went to see his supervisor, and he said, "I quit." And the supervisor said, "Well, I don't blame you, because all you've done since you've been here is complain, complain, complain." But we're going to learn that as Christians, we're not to retreat from the world, even though in a real way we're to be separate from the world, but God has placed us in the world to win the world. Now, this section of 1 John is all about spiritual growth, and Michael talked about that last week. Some like are spiritual babies, children, some are like spiritual students, some are like spiritual adults, and we ought to be able to mark our growth. You know, if you go to my house, our house, in the doorway of the closet of Cindy's study, there's some markings on the inside of a closet door facing, and it marks the growing height of my four grandchildren. So there's marks there for Jenny and for Caroline and for Grant and for Ada. And so I'm happy to announce that all four of my grandchildren are now taller than Cindy's mother. So it's been great to watch that progress. But wouldn't it be good if you could also track your spiritual growth just as precisely? And one of the ways you can tell where you are in your terms of spiritual maturity is, how are you doing in terms of spiritual warfare? Because every Christian is involved in spiritual warfare, but are you getting beat up all the time, or are you finding victory in Jesus? Now, when we talk about spiritual warfare, we are battling against one enemy on three fronts. Now, think about World War II. There was one enemy, but we were fighting on two fronts, the European front and the Pacific front. And as followers of Jesus Christ, we have one enemy that we fight on three fronts. We fight the world, that's what we'll talk about today, the flesh, and the devil. The world, the flesh, and the devil. The world is our external foe, our flesh is our internal foe, and the devil is the infernal foe. And all of these work together to try to get us to disobey God and to do the opposite of God's will. And in this passage today, John is going to tell us how we should relate to the world, because the world wants us to turn away from God and His Word. And so we're going to read this three verses here, 1 John 2:15 through 17. I would invite you to stand as we honor God through the reading of His holy Word. He says, "Do not love the world or the things of the world." And the good thing is he tells us what some of these things are, three things. "If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world," and note these three, "the lust or the desires of the flesh. Secondly, the lust or the desires of the eyes. And thirdly, the pride in one's possessions," literally the pride of life. And he says, "None of this is from the Father, but it is from the world. And the world with all of its lust is passing away, but the one who does the will of God remains forever." Let's pray. Father, we know that you want us to live holy lives. You want us to live lives where we are in a position where you can bless us because of our obedience, and make us aware, Lord, of our enemy and the victory that we have in Jesus. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. You see, God doesn't want us to escape from the world. In fact, Jesus prayed in that high priestly prayer in John 17, "Father, I don't pray that they are taken from the world, but just as you sent me into the world, so I send them into the world." Now think of it like this. If any of you own a boat, it's a good thing for a boat to be in the water, but if the water gets in the boat, you're in trouble. And as followers of Jesus Christ, we are in the world, but if the world ever gets in us, then that's a sign of trouble. So in this passage of Scripture, John, the apostle, is giving us five choices that we get to make, and sometimes these are daily choices that we have to make as it relates to the world. And here's decision number one. Loving God is better than loving this world. And look again at verse 15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, let me explain this. Now, this is not talking about the world of humanity, okay? Because God so loved the world of humanity that he gave his one and only son, Jesus, okay? And this is not talking about don't love the world, meaning in terms of the earth, the planet, because the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and all of the fullness in it. Now, this word world is a word that's translated, it's the translation of the Greek word cosmos. It appears over 30 times in the New Testament. We get our word cosmopolitan from it. It is a mindset. It is a lifestyle that is contrary to God. Well, you just think about it. I think somebody told me there's a mixed drink called Cosmopolitan. I know there's a women's magazine named Cosmopolitan because I looked it up and I was going to put a cover of Cosmopolitan on the screens, but I was too embarrassed. It was not a suitable for all eyes, you see. But that's kind of the attitude when it comes to fashion, fads, lifestyle. There is this thing called the world. And if you still don't understand it, Warren Wiersbe, who's one of my favorite New Testament scholars, he gives us a very concise identification of what the world is in the New Testament. The world, named here, meaning in this passage, as our enemy, is an invisible spiritual system opposed to God and Christ. Satan is called the god, small g, of this world, 2 Corinthians 4:4, and he leads an organization of evil spirits working with him to oppose the work of Christ on earth. Now think about it. Just as the Holy Spirit uses people to accomplish God's will on earth, so Satan uses people to fulfill his evil purposes. And all throughout the Bible, we have a contrast. Jesus talked about the children of the world as opposed to children of God. He talked about the wisdom of this world compared to the wisdom of God, which comes from above. And this passage of Scripture is saying, you know what, if you claim to love the world, you don't love God. That's what it means, is a choice between the two. And sometimes we talk about somebody, well, you know, they are a worldly Christian. Well, Vance Havner said this. He said, there's no such thing as a worldly Christian. You could just as well call someone a heavenly devil. The words cancel out each other. In fact, the Bible says if you love the world and you're in love with the world, then the love of God is not part of your life. You have to choose one or the other. That's what Jesus said in Matthew 6:24. Look at Matthew 6:24. Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. I used to say that is the prohibition in the Bible for polygamy. Think about it. No man can serve two masters. Jesus said, since either he will hate one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other, you cannot serve both God and money. And in the King James Bible, it says God and mammon, because that's the literal translation of the word mammon, which means accumulations that have been gotten by ill means. In fact, in the medieval times, there was an ugly demon who was named Mammon, who was the demon of wealth that had been accumulated in unethical and unlawful ways. And so God, the Bible says you got to choose, or am I going to love God, or am I going to love the world and the things of the world? So let's unpack it a little bit more, because he names three things that are of the world. So the next decision is this. Following your new nature is better than following your sinful nature. And the first of the three things he mentions are the lust of the flesh is from the world. Now, you and I, when we become a Christian, we receive a new nature. And is the holy nature of God as the Holy Spirit comes to take residence in our lives, representing Jesus, Christ in you, the hope of glory. But you know, God doesn't take away that old sinful nature that we were born with. He leaves it there. I wish he would take it away, but it's still there. And we have to battle with it every day. In fact, the Apostle Paul, who we would probably call a super Christian, in Romans chapter 7, he bemoans the fact about this battle. He says, you know, why is it? The things that I want to do, the good things I want to do, I just don't do them. And he said, on the other thing, those bad things I don't want to do, I find myself doing them. Who shall deliver me from this body of sin? He just really talks about his frustration, but don't ever read chapter 7 of Romans without going on and to read chapter 8 of Romans, and he tells us how we can have spiritual victory. But he talked about this inner fighting. You know, sometimes in cartoons, you'll see a person, they'll have like an angel on one shoulder and like the devil on the other shoulder. You've seen this. And the devil is saying, you know, hey, go ahead and do this. Everybody's doing it. You'll get away with it. There are no consequences for your sins. And the angel, on the other hand, is whispering, no, don't do that. This displeases God. If you do this, there's consequences for your sin. There's these two natures that are always struggling with us. Well, it's not really an angel. It's not really a devil. It's just these two natures that we have. And we are the ones that get to choose what we do morally, okay? It's like our flesh says, do this. And the devil says, do this. The world says, do this. And we get to make the deciding choice. I read a story one time about a missionary who had taken the gospel to some Native American tribes in what we call above the Arctic Circle in Alaska. They're not really called Eskimos because that was a general term of all those different tribes up there. But this missionary had taken the gospel to one particular tribe, and they had received the gospel, and the entire village became Christians. And the missionary was checking in on them, and the chief of the tribe was talking about the struggle that he had. And the missionary said, what struggle are you talking about? And the chief said, well, it's like this. He said, it's like inside me there is a black dog that's always telling me to do wrong, and then there's a white dog that's always telling me to do right. And these two dogs are always fighting because they come from a culture of dogs and sled dogs and things. And so the missionary says, I understand, which dog wins the fight? And the chief said, the one I feed the most. So my friend, you can feed your sinful nature by what you watch, by what you hear, by what you participate in, or you can feed your godly nature by what you watch, by what you read, and by what you hear. Because you see, you have all these openings into your soul, your eyes, your ears, your mouth, and the one you feed the most usually wins. So that's the second decision. Choose your better nature, your new nature. Number three, the third decision is this. Being content is better than coveting. And again, we see the second source of the world's enticement, the lust of the eyes, is from the world. Now, the word lust there is not taken in the sexual connotation, although it involves that. Jesus said, if you look at a woman and lust after her, but it's a general word that means to desire something. And what it means is you see something and you say, you know what? I've got to have that, and I've got to have it right now. I want that. That's sparkly. It's new. I don't have it. I want it right now. You know, that's why God gave the 10th commandment. And you know what the 10th commandment says? It says, you shall not covet your neighbor's possessions or your neighbor's people, because it talks about your neighbor's wife or his servants. Don't covet your neighbor's possessions or his people. And a lot of people don't understand what coveting is. In fact, you've heard of Father Francis Xavier. It had nothing to do with the X-Men, by the way. This is a real guy that lived. Xavier University is named after him. He was a Catholic priest for 45 years. And he said in 45 years of listening to confession from Catholics, he never one time had anyone confess the sin of covetousness. Never one time. Because it's kind of that invisible sin that you can have and then you don't really know it. But here's what it is. It's keeping up with the Joneses. You understand what that is? I mean, you see your neighbors drive up in a new car and you say, well, you know what? I got to get me a new car. And then you get that new car and you feel good about it for a while, but then it gets a few miles on it, and then you see somebody driving a newer, nicer car, and you're saying, well, I wish I had that one. Or you build what you think is your dream home, and you say, this is it, I'm going to be happy forever. And then you drive in another neighborhood, and you see a bigger, better home, and you're thinking, wow, I wish I had that home. You see, it's a vicious cycle of unsatisfaction, of always wanting more, more, more. That's what greed is. It is a vicious cycle. And let me just tell you what the cure for covetousness is. Because the way you cure any disease is by taking the right medicine. And the cure for covetousness is something called contentment in Christ. And I want to ask you today, how content are you? How content are you with what you have? Because the Bible says godliness with contentment is great gain. Now, there's a guy on YouTube that I like to listen to, a Bible teacher. His name is Matt Whitman, if you want to write his name down. He has a YouTube Bible study that's called the 10-Minute Bible Hour. I love it. He's funny. He's good. He's on target. And he has a series called Matt Whitman Destroys All the Precious Bible Verses. In other words, he takes all these Bible verses, the treasures that we think these Bible verses are great, and he gives the right definition of them, and it ruins it for you, okay? And I'm setting you up because one of the verses that he talks about is Philippians 4:13, which is, it says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I mean, people have taken that to mean, you know what? I can win the game. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can get that job. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can pass this test. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. This is not just some random promise. It is a very specific promise that must be taken in context. And you know what the context of it is? Paul's in prison and he's hungry. He's poor. And he says, you know what? Things are tough. But you know what? God can make me content even in prison. That is the context of that great Bible promise. In fact, look at it for yourself. Philippians chapter 4, beginning in verse 12, he says, I know how to make do with little. I know how to make do with a lot. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being content, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in abundance or need. And here is the context of this great promise that we always take out of context and put on our wall framed. I am able to do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In other words, the strength that Jesus wants to give you is the strength to be content whether you have a lot or whether you have a little. So choose contentment instead of covetousness, because you know what? The lust of the flesh will get you in trouble, and the lust of the eyes will also get you in trouble. But then he mentions a third source of trouble. Number four decision, being humble is better than pride. Being humble is better than pride. And he talks about the pride of one's possessions. It's actually the word possessions is the word bios. So I really do think a better translation is a pride of life, which includes both your possessions, your fame, your fortune, your influence, your position, being proud about something like that. And the Bible says all of that is from the world. I think it's talking about the tendency that people have to be arrogant about their lifestyle. And I know many, many years ago, I'm dating myself, there used to be a television show, Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, and these were people who had really made it, and we all looked at them and said, wow, wish we could be like them. But today, fame and fortune take on a little different appearance than they used to. Today, all of you know that a lot of influence today is only virtual influence. You say, what do you mean by that? Well, across all the social media platforms, there are people who are called influencers. You heard of them? They may or may not be famous, but just because they have a large number of followers or subscribers, they're considered to be influencers, and they are so proud of how many followers they have. All right, it's trivia time. Who has the most number of Instagram followers in the world? What person? Shout it out if you know. Cristiano Ronaldo. Okay, did somebody say that? I couldn't hear it all, but yeah, the soccer player who played for Portugal, he has 254 million followers. But there are all these people that you've never heard of before who may have a million or two followers, and that's all they do. They just they just post themselves. Because you know, the number one object to be photographed today is what? Me. Me. And we are the generation of the selfie. And that's what we post. Me doing this, me eating this, me dancing this, me saying this. That's our generation. And it's exactly what this passage is talking about, just the pride of life. You know, but you know what? We're not the first selfie. You read about the first selfie in Isaiah 14, and his name was Lucifer. And he said, you know what? I'm not satisfied with my position. I need more followers, so I'm going to ascend on high, and I'm going to take over the throne of God. I'm going up, 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 up. My numbers are going to climb, climb, climb. And God said, no, devil, you're not going up, up, up. You're going down, down, down. And you're going to keep on going down until one day you're chained in the pit of hell forever and ever and ever. So the Bible says that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And know that if you try to exalt yourself, the Bible says, God will humble you. But if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. Now, I want you to think about Satan's strategy, how he uses the things of the world. He uses the desires of your flesh. Now, what does that mean? Well, we all have normal God-given appetites, that there are normal God-blessed ways to satisfy those appetites. And the world says, satisfy them in unhealthy ways. For instance, everybody has a sex drive, and God has given us the relationship of marriage to have that sex drive met. And Paul even says he's given some people the gift of singleness so they don't need marriage. But you know what the world says? Hey, you know what? Sex, anywhere, anytime, with anyone, as long as it's consensual, that's the attitude of the world. For instance, we all have a desire to be fed, to eat. And there's a healthy way to do that. But the unhealthy way to do that is by overeating and by putting in your body things that are not good for your body, that will destroy your body. See, God says these are healthy appetites. The world says fulfill them in unhealthy ways. God gave us all the desire to rest, to sleep. And the world says, yeah, I just sleep all the time. And the book of Proverbs warns about the dangers of laziness. That's what the devil does. He tries to take all these healthy appetites God has given us and give us opportunities in the world to fulfill them in unhealthy ways, the lust or desires of the flesh. And then it's the lust of the eyes. Wow, I just got to have that. That looks good. That's flashy. It's sparkly. I want it. And then the pride of life. You know what? If I do this, people will like me more. I'll have more friends. And you know what? This is absolutely nothing new for the devil. That's exactly what he did in the Garden of Eden with Eve when it came to the forbidden fruit. In fact, I want you to read, or you just listen as I read, Genesis 3:6. The woman saw that the tree was good, the lust of the eyes. It was good for food. In other words, it'll be good for my flesh. And it's delightful to look at, the lust of the eyes. And that it was desirable for attaining wisdom. You know what? If I eat this, I will be like God. So she took some of its fruit and she ate it. The desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life. Satan doesn't do anything new. It's the same strategy he's using against you and me today. Here's the final decision. Living forever is better than perishing. I say amen to that, but that's the choice we're given here in verse 17. It says, the world with all of its lust, with all of its desires, is passing away, but the one who does the will of God remains forever. You know what that means? The world is full of fads and fashions and gimmicks, and all of those things, they come for a while, but then they all pass away. Can you think about all the fads and fashions that used to be in that are out? I talked about when I was in high school, we wore, you know, like pastel-colored shirts and pants that were way up above the ankle, and your socks had to match the color of your shirt. You know, that was the style. And we wore penny loafers, and we put a penny in the little slot. Oh, man, we were cool when we did that. And I tell you what, that's past. That's way past, okay? I remember when my daughters were teenagers, they said, hey, Daddy, I got to have me some boots called Doc Martens. And I remember going to the Broadway Square Mall and walking in the shoe store, and I said, those are what we used to call work boots for the field. And you want to buy those to wear to school? And they did. And I even bought a pair for myself, which made my girls not want to wear them, of course. But they wore them for a while because it was the fad. But my granddaughters tell me that Doc Martens are now back in, but they'll be out for a while. In fact, I asked some of my Facebook friends, what are some things that were fads and fashions that are totally passed away and should never come back again? And here's a list some of my friends gave me. And raise your hand if you ever did this or you know somebody that did. Shoulder pads for women. Oh, yeah, don't do that. Mullet haircuts. Anybody ever have a mullet? All right, women, big hair teased up like Farrah Fawcett from the 80s. Yeah, probably with a scrunchie or something. Fanny packs. Platform shoes. Fidget spinners. That's just recent. Harem pants. And you can all relate to this one. Thank God this is gone. The Macarena. Bedazzled denim, leisure suits, Crocs, ripped knee jeans, jelly sandals, bell bottoms, tight roll jeans, blue eyeshadow, ducktail haircuts. And this is from really, really old friends of mine. Ducktail haircuts and lots of petticoats. You know, the attitude of the world is, you know, enjoy this fashion because you only live here at once, and so grab for everything you can. In fact, in the 1960s, there was a beer company that was their slogan. It said, you only go around life once, so grab for all the gusto you can get. And later it became YOLO, you only live once. But by the way, that was Schlitz beer. Now they're actually out of business and have been since 1982, so I guess they didn't go around but once themselves. But that's the attitude of the world. It's only one life, so just live it up, buy into all the fads, buy into all the fashions, just live it up because there's only one life. And the Word of God says, no, all these things are passing away, but he who does the will of the Father lives forever. Everything in this world, and even the things that are fads right now. I mean, Instagram, TikTok, I promise you, in 10 years, everybody's going to be saying, hey, do you remember Instagram and TikTok? That is so old and out of fad and fashion. Everything's going to pass away, except those who do the will of the Father. So here's how we relate to the world. The world wants to merge us into their mindset and to their lifestyle. And here's a great illustration of it, because 20 years ago, I went with some men from Green Acres down to Manaus, Brazil, on the Amazon River, where we were building a church, and we took a boat ride out on the Amazon River. And the northern tributary of the Amazon River at Manaus is called the Rio Negro. It is a black river that flows into the muddy Amazon River. And you can see a picture of it here. Because for 50 miles, they run separated from each other for 50 full miles. And by the way, that picture in the middle is a freshwater dolphin. There are freshwater dolphins in the Amazon, 800 miles from the Atlantic Ocean in any salt water. But they run for 50 miles separated, Amazon, Rio Negro. But then eventually they all mix together. And that's the picture of a worldly Christian. And we ought to be like this picture. We ought to be there touching the world, influencing the world. But the world should not be influencing us. And we shouldn't be merged into the world. Because the Bible says in Romans 12, 2, it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, the world wants to draw you in. It wants to entice you into its lifestyle, its mindset, its habits, its way of thinking. My friend, this world is not all there is. Jesus said, you know what? My kingdom is not of this world. Because there is another world, and we have another home, and we're just passing through this world. So don't get sucked into the enticements of this world. So, you know, in Greek mythology, there was these combination female bird-like creatures called sirens in the Homer's Odyssey and also Jason and the Argonauts. And these sirens would be on rocks, and when mariners would sail by, they would sing a song that was so enticing that the sailors would direct their ships toward their song, and they would be shipwrecked and die. So if you know anything about those two stories, you know that Odysseus, whenever he passed by in his ship, he put beeswax in all the ears of his sailors so they couldn't hear it. Then he lashed himself to the mast. And so as he passed by, he heard the siren song, and he was in such agony and torment because he wanted to break away and go to that sound. But then there was another way that Jason, in the story of the Argonauts, handled the song of the siren. He had on board his boat a gifted musician by the name of Orpheus. And so he didn't stop up the ears of his sailors. He didn't lash anybody to the mast. Instead, as they passed by the sirens, this gifted musician with a 7-string guitar named Orpheus sang a song that was louder and more beautiful than the songs of the enticing sirens, and they passed by without being drawn into their trap. What a great illustration for us, folks. We have so much in our life as followers of Jesus Christ to keep the sound of the world away. That's why we listen to praise music. That's why we read the Word of God. That's why we associate with believers, because there's so much in our lives that will keep us away from the enticement that the world has for us. And it's a good thing. You know why? Because the world is passing away. And if you're part of the world, you're going to be part of all that that's passing away. But if you plant your life in God, it is eternal. Because this life's going to end. We all know that. So let me finish by asking you, think back. When in your life were you closest to death? I know some people have just gotten out of the hospital and survived COVID, and they said, well, I was really close to death then. And thank God that you survived. Many didn't. But really, that wasn't when you were closest to death, because guess what? You're alive. I had an automobile accident one time, and I was in ICU, and I almost died. Well, yeah, thank God you survived. The truth is, for every one of us, the closest we've ever been to death is this moment. This moment. And that's why the Bible says our life is but a mist that passes away. So that's why we need to prepare every day to make the right choices when it comes to relating to the world and obeying God. And if you're not ready to meet God, that's the most important decision you can make today. So would you bow your heads with me and pray? And if you're here today and you don't know the Lord, you're not ready to meet God, would you be willing just to say this prayer silently to God in your heart? Dear God, I admit I'm a sinner. I'll never be good enough to earn forgiveness. So instead, I accept your free gift of eternal life in Jesus Christ. I believe Jesus died on the cross for me. I believe you raised him from the dead. Right now, Lord, come into my life and take control. And I want to live forever with you. In Jesus' name, amen.